thank you, Cindy. That was lovely. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning through Jamestown Presbyterian Church. Welcome to all of you who are watching via our live stream or later through the internet. We have a few announcements this morning. As you probably are aware, we are primarily live streaming. We are not doing in-person worship for the next three Sundays, today, the 27th of December, and then also on the 3rd of January because of the government shutdown, well, the restrictions. However, Christmas Eve, we are having in-person worship by reservation only. So if you are feeling well, if you would like to take part in our Christmas Eve candlelight service here at Jamestown Pres, that's going to be 7 o'clock on the 24th, Christmas Eve. You do need to call in to the church office in order to make reservations and confirm those reservations. And space available, we would be delighted to see you, to have you worship and celebrate with us. We will be observing all COVID-19 precautions for that. So to make reservations or if you have questions, you can contact the church office by Tuesday afternoon of this week, please. Because then it's only a few days for Christmas Eve. A couple of other announcements. Steve and Linda Pinney's son, his wife, had a little baby boy earlier this week. It is the Pinney's first grandchild. I don't know the baby's name. Did anybody hear that? I don't know the baby's name, but we are celebrating with them. Cindy shared that she has two nephews who are home after military deployment, one to Afghanistan and one to Alaska. And I understand that there are several young people in Jamestown who, following high school graduation, have entered the military, have completed their basic training, and are back for the holidays for the first time after going into the service. So we rejoice with their families that they're able to be here. Some other news, Linda and Dave Velasson were in an auto accident. Not a major auto accident, but an auto accident in the snow on Wednesday. Dave is fine. Linda suffered a broken arm. So please keep them in your prayers. Mary Kidwell has fallen and broken her hip. She's in the hospital down in Jamestown, I believe. She'll be having surgery on that. Dave Melton had some back surgery, unexpected back surgery on Thursday. He is in the hospital in Sharon, and so we want to add them, Dave and Gladys, to our prayers. Let's see, had some other announcements. Bob Moore had open heart surgery, and we want to keep the Shannon family in our prayers. Also, Rick Chess has passed away, so we want to keep his wife in prayers. You know, there's quite a lot of announcements. Are there other things that we need to remember? No? All right. Well, let us then take just a moment in silence, and then I'll lead us in the call to worship and the litany of the Advent wreath. Now, if you'll join with me, please, in the call to worship. We have come to worship God, our Creator and King,
who has compassion on the weak and afflicted.
At just the right time, God sent us a Savior,
His only begotten Son, Christ Jesus, our Lord.
The first three candles on the Advent wreath are reminders of the hope, peace, and joy Jesus brings.
The fourth candle reminds us that God's love is most fully revealed in the person and work of Jesus. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called the children of God.
And now please, let us sing together the first two verses or stanzas of Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne. That's hymn number 170. Trusting in God's love for us in Jesus Christ, a love that caused Jesus to step down out of the glories of heaven and enter our world. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. We will begin with a silent and personal confession and then a unison prayer. Let us pray. Now joining together in a unison prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, eternal Son of the Father, you set aside your divine majesty and stepped out of the glory of heaven to enter our world as a vulnerable baby, so that you could bring light to our darkness and healing to our sick and sorrowing world. We bow before you, O God, humbled by the enormity of your mercy. Grant us courage and wisdom to give up whatever hinders us from loving you and one another. Forgive our sin and purify our hearts, we pray. And grant that as Christmas comes again for us this year, we will be filled to overflowing with fresh wonder and gratitude for your extravagant grace. Amen. Comfort, comfort my people, says our God. So hear and believe the good news. In Christ, your sins and mine are forgiven.
In Jesus Christ,
we are set free. Thanks be to God.
Holy One, giver of life and light. God who restores, you have done great things for us, and so we rejoice. So very often you have filled us with gladness. You even turn our sorrow into shouts of joy. So we thank you for sending good news to us in and through Jesus Christ. And we thank you for restoring so very much that we have broken. In this season of light, we lift up in prayer the many who still wait in darkness, people all around the world who are suffering from poverty and discrimination, by political unrest, or who are oppressed by dangerous rulers. We lift up people who have been imprisoned wrongly, and also those who have been imprisoned justly, O Lord. But may prisoners not be forgotten, may they not suffer unduly, but may those times be an opportunity for repentance and change of heart and new life. We lift up all those who live in fear and anxiety. We pray, O Lord, that you would make the brokenhearted whole and comfort those who mourn, especially, O Lord, the family of Rick Jess and those who have passed away, either due to the COVID virus or through any other reason in this Christmas season and the days prior. Lord, we thank you that you have come so that we may have no fear of death, but nevertheless we mourn our losses with heavy hearts. So we ask for comfort. We ask for continued healing, Lord, for Dave Melton and Dave and Linda Blossom, for Bob Moore, for Mary Kidwell, for all those whose names have not been mentioned aloud, whether it's part of this community or all around the world, those who are suffering from illness, disease, or the effects from old age. Lay your hand of healing, that pain may be reduced, that bodies and hearts and spirits may be restored. And Lord, give us also confidence in trusting that it is your hand of healing, not mere science, but that science is guided by you, healers, and those who work in medical fields of all kinds are guided by your spirit, whether they acknowledge that or not. For from you comes all healing, all health, all wholeness. And Lord, we pray that even in these days when we are asked to keep our physical distance, you would help us to remain close to one another. Thank you for technology of various kinds. But we know that there are many, O Lord, who still grieve and who are feeling very low in this time of year because we are unable to connect with our usual family and friends. We are unable to go out and about in the ways that we might normally do. But you are ever with us. Help us to lean upon your presence and help us as your faithful people to reach out to others in your name and your spirit. In light of the world, we are thankful that in the coming of Christ, you have come to live among and within us always. And so now it is in his name and his spirit that we pray in the words that Jesus gave us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, friends, A number of folks have contacted the church office asking how they may give during this season when we are having only the very limited in-person worship service. Only a handful of people are gathered here. Most are staying home. So there can be gifts that can be mailed to the church. You can also give online through our website. There's a button up at the top right-hand side of our website that will provide a number of different options where you can give. Thank you for your continued and generous gifts. We know that all that we have is a gift first from God. And he asks only that we are wise stewards of what he has entrusted to us for a little while. So thank you for being faithful stewards. Thank you for the gifts that support this congregation, this ministry, and through which we can serve the community. May the Lord bless the gifts. May the Lord bless the givers, even as we praise and thank our gracious God. So now let us sing together the doxology. This morning comes from the first chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. It is a well-known passage, often read during this time of year. We begin with verse 18, continuing through 25. Hear the word of the Lord. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, Yeshua, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and Joseph gave him the name Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, this morning I wanted to take some time to consider the faithfulness of Joseph, that is, Joseph of Nazareth. We hear a lot about Mary, and rightly so. She was, after all, the mother of Jesus, and Scripture mentions her presence at various times through his life, but beginning, of course, before his birth, all the way through childhood and even to his death on the cross. But what do we know about Joseph? In all the New Testament, he never even says a single word, and he seems to disappear entirely sometime after Jesus was 12 years old. We only have a few references. And yet, Joseph is one of the principal figures in the Christmas drama. So we're going to take a few moments this morning and focus on him. Now, tradition has it that Joseph was just a simple man, a carpenter from Nazareth. Sometimes you might have seen Sunday school pictures showing him in a wood shop making furniture. But the Greek word carpenter in Joseph's day referred to a skilled craftsman who might have worked with a wide range of materials. So he could just as easily have been working with metal or stone as with wood. Now, near the town of Nazareth, there was a regional capital, Sepphoris, and it was being constructed and renovated and expanded during that time. Now, Sepphoris was within walking distance of Nazareth, so it's very possible that Joseph was one of the workers there, perhaps a stonemason or a Finnish carpenter. In any case, craftsmen had strong backs and calloused hands. They learned their trade by serving an apprenticeship, and they held a respectable place in society, even if it wasn't very high on the ladder, if you will, of social achievement. Now, you might remember, there's a passage in Mark that talks about Jesus' first sermon. It was in a synagogue in Nazareth. And the elders raised their eyebrows and asked, "Isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph, Judah and Simon?" Joseph was not a rabbi, he wasn't a scribe, he wasn't a civic leader. He had only two qualifications for his role as Jesus' foster father. First, he was a descendant of King David. And more significantly, he was God's choice, for whatever reason. Now, I like to think that Joseph is someone with whom we can identify, someone we would look up to and emulate, an ordinary person in many ways, and yet fervently desiring to obey God's will for his life. Now, Joseph's place in the Christmas story, of course, is well known. He is Mary's husband. But we need to talk a little bit about what that meant. As we read in the Gospel of Matthew, Joseph and Mary were betrothed, but then a few verses later, Matthew calls Joseph her husband. So William Barclay, who's a commentator, a biblical scholar, well known, he explains that there were three steps or three stages in a Jewish marriage. The first step, the engagement, was often arranged by the parents when the boy and girl were still children. Typical for the girl to be somewhat younger, the boy to be somewhat older, but still, the early arrangements were made often through the parents. But then a year or so, just about a year before the wedding, the couple would be formally betrothed. That involved a signed contract that set out the terms of the marriage, things like the dowry. And finally, there was the wedding celebration itself, which often lasted a whole week, and only then was the marriage consummated. During the betrothal, the couple was legally bound to each other, so that if the man died before the actual wedding took place, the woman was considered to be a widow. They were referred to as husband and wife, though they did not live together, and they refrained from sexual intimacy. So it was at that stage in their relationship, while they were betrothed, that Joseph learned the news of Mary's pregnancy. The scripture doesn't tell us exactly, but I think it's safe to imagine his reaction. He would have been very upset, to say the least, and probably angry, filled with a sense of betrayal and wounded pride. After all, if Mary was pregnant, The only logical explanation would have been that she had been unfaithful with another man. And if that was true, Joseph had the legal right to publicly accuse her and have her stoned to death. Well, it's at this point that Joseph demonstrates his faithfulness, first to Mary, and then his faithfulness to God. As we heard in Matthew, when Joseph learned that Mary was pregnant, he didn't want to make a public example of her. Instead, he intended to divorce her quietly, or as some translations say, to put her away secretly. Joseph was a man of quiet strength. He was a man of integrity, true to his convictions, faithful to God. He was compassionate and considerate of others. And when you take all these things together, you can see easily that Joseph found himself in a no-win situation. He couldn't, in good conscience, go forward with the wedding. He just couldn't do that. But he couldn't bring himself to humiliate Mary either, let alone have her put to death. So breaking off the relationship quietly, not making a fuss about it, seemed to be the most honorable thing to do. And truly, if that is what Scripture said he had decided and we knew the situation, we would have understood. We would have still respected him as a man of faith, a man of compassion. But that's not what he did. Because Joseph had a dream. Now, if we just stopped there, we might remember another Joseph, years and years and years, centuries before, who had dreams, one after the other, talking about Joseph years ago, before God's people went down into Egypt. So people listening to this scripture, what Matthew says, that Joseph had a dream, they would remember that God was at work. And in this dream, the dream that, you know, the Mary's betrothed Joseph had, an angel appeared to him and told him that the child in Mary's womb was of the Holy Spirit, and he should go forward and raise that child as though it was his own. Now, it would be tempting for us, reading this story all this time after the fact, and knowing the story, knowing how it turns out, it would be tempting for us to say, well, there you have it. The angel came to him in a dream, told Joseph it was all going to be okay. So he went ahead with the wedding, and simple as that. But was it really? Do you think it was really that simple? Because we've all had it. Dreams. They're not always clear, but even when they're clear, they can be pretty bizarre. The meaning can be pretty elusive. I don't know many folks who make major life decisions based on a dream. I would expect that when Joseph awoke, he also did some praying about this. But when he woke, he went ahead and did as the angel of the Lord commanded. Now, I think what's pretty remarkable here is that he didn't brush off the dream. He didn't stick with his original course of action, which was a very logical decision to quietly break things off and then go on about his life without Mary. Instead, he trusted that that message from the angel was a message from God. He chose to believe that God was doing something different and much greater than what Joseph had envisioned. And so he took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate the marriage until she had given birth to her firstborn son. And then there was one more thing, one more part of the command from the angel that Joseph followed through on. He publicly named the baby, named him Jesus. Doing so, claiming that child by Joseph naming the child, he was claiming the child as his own. He placed Jesus within the lineage of a royal house, the house of David. And because of the faithfulness of Joseph, Jesus would have not only a human father, a foster father, yes, but an adoptive human father. But Joseph would have this well-known place in the story of God's salvation. It's a story of saying yes. It's a story of saying no, and we'll get to that in a moment. To the world, this obedience, this faithfulness of Joseph may seem unrealistic, even foolish, gullible, right? But Joseph's decision ought to strike a very familiar chord in the hearts of all followers of Jesus. Because think about it, aren't all Christians called to let go of our own agendas, to let go of the way we thought things ought to be, and instead embrace God's plan for our lives? How many times in life we are faced with the choice between having our way and allowing God to have his way in and through us. You know what I mean. It might not be something as dramatic as the choice that was faced by Joseph, but haven't we all had times when society tells us we have every right to do such and such a thing? But we know, deep inside, God is calling us to take a different path in order to serve a greater good, a greater purpose. I'm not talking about being a doormat, a wet noodle. I'm just talking about being open to what God has in store for us and for the world in which we live when we say, "Not my will, O Lord, but thine be done." Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Gracious God, when we hear those words, "Thy will be done," several things come into our memory. We think of Mary saying, "Let it be with me as you have said." We think of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane praying, "If it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but thine." And though Holy Scripture doesn't record even a single word from Joseph's mouth, we know that after your angel spoke to him in a dream, he awoke. And then he did as you commanded. So grant to us, O God, clarity in knowing your will in large things and in small, so that we too may serve you and your purpose. Through Christ and for his glory we pray. Amen. Amen. So friends, our time together is coming to an end. Once again, you are invited to join with the Christmas Eve worship service here on Thursday evening at 7 o'clock, but that is by reservation only, so be sure that if you are planning to come to the Christmas Eve service, you do let the church office know, since space is limited. And now, let us join in singing our final hymn, "O Little Town of Bethlehem." in peace, in joy, in love, in hope. Go out into the world singing God's praises, telling of his goodness, being the people that God has called you to be, so that all may know the glory of God shining among us, so that all may know there is indeed a Savior, not only for long ago, but a Savior for today, tomorrow, and even forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.